If you're listening to this when it comes out, you may know that next week I'm going to a huge conference for podcasters known as Podcast Movement. And I thought it only appropriate to do an episode related to this. You may be using the technology of today's episode right now and listening to this episode with it. You may even have been appalled 2 years ago when Apple announced it was getting rid of the jack to plug today's episode topic into on their iPhones. Nevertheless, almost everybody has a pair or two nowadays, and many, like me, may not even use them for their intended purpose, which is to listen to music or podcasts, but as a way to safeguard ourselves from talkative coworkers or overly friendly salespeople. I'm your host, Emily Prokop, and this is the story behind headphones. But first, a quick message. I've been talking about it for months, and I am so excited to announce that the Story Behind book is available for pre-sale. The book is based on the podcast and features 50 different topics, some we've talked about in past episodes and some that are brand new and will probably never make it to the podcast. The Story Behind will be available October 15th, 2018, but you can pre-order your copy on Amazon or Barnes & Noble today. There will be links in the show notes, or you can go to thestorybehindbook.com. Also, yay! When we talked about the story behind the stethoscope a few weeks ago on the show, you might remember the binaural stethoscope, meaning the stethoscope with two earpieces, was invented in 1850, but it took a few more years for headphones to come along. Some sources cite headphones' history beginning with telephone operators using a single earpiece that rested on their shoulders, weighing more than 10 pounds. If you were around in the 80s, go ahead and picture that Sony boombox you rocked on your shoulder while wearing hammer pants to get an idea of that kind of weight and sound. And almost 15 years later, in a weird mix of telephone and stethoscope technology, an electrophone system was created so people could listen to the opera from the comfort of their own home. In 1891, French engineer Ernest Mercadier was awarded the first patent for in-ear headphones, which were able to block out external sounds for phone operators. But it was in 1910 that the predecessor for today's headphones were invented in the kitchen of engineer Nathaniel Baldwin. While it's most likely true, the legend goes that the U.S. Navy received tons of letters from ambitious inventors every day, hoping their inventions could be used for military purposes. When a letter came across Lieutenant Commander A.J. Hepburn's desk on pink and blue stationery, written in purple ink, the writer claimed to have invented a headset that could amplify sound. Hepburn laughed, but tried them out anyway. After his trial, though, he found them to be the most efficient headset he had ever tried, and after corresponding with its inventor, Baldwin, Hepburn asked him to tweak the design for better comfort, including adding the over-the-head harness we're familiar with today. The U.S. Navy commissioned Baldwin for more headphones on the eve of World War I. Since he was reluctant to move his operations out of his kitchen, Baldwin could only produce 10 at a time. Hepburn urged him to patent the design and set up a factory. Baldwin did eventually set up a factory, and there's even a rumor that the first television set may have been invented there by one of his employees. However, he never did file a patent on the redesigned headphones, leaving the market open for competition, which eventually put a dent in Baldwin's sales over time. All right, I'll be honest, I'm not the most technology-savvy person in the world, so I won't go into too much depth about the technology behind the headphones, but there are a few different types, the most common being dynamic headphones. But basically, they use magnetism to turn electrical energy into sound. They work pretty much the same way speakers work, although on a much smaller scale, and earbuds on an even smaller scale. The German company Beyer Dynamic invented the first dynamic headphones in 1937, although they had to halt production during World War II. But following the war, production picked up, and their DT48 model was still in production until 2012. Music listening was forever changed when John C. Koss invented stereo headphones in 1958. They were invented as an accessory at first for a high-fidelity phonograph player, but the headphones ended up being the hit, allowing people to listen to music if they've never heard it before, adding more depth and a wider range of frequencies. If you've ever wondered about stereo versus mono, by the way, take a listen to California Dreamin' by the Mamas and the Papas with just one earbud in. It's recorded in stereo with certain instruments and vocals on either one side or the other. If you're listening in the car or with both headphones in, you might not notice a difference. So let's try a little experiment. This is how it sounds in mono, where everything syncs together.
All the leaves are brown, and the sky is gray.
And this is how it sounds only on the right side in stereo. And then here's the left side.
I'd be safe and warm if I was in LA.
So for you podcasters out there wondering if you should record in stereo with one host on one side and another co-host on the other, no, never do this. Weirdos like me sometimes listen with just one earbud in, and while I love the Mamas and the Papas, I always had to skip their songs every time I listened just for that reason. Before there were Beats by Dr. Dre, celebrity-endorsed headphones really made an impact on the market, as far back as Tony Bennett endorsing Koss headphones. Koss also created a pair of midline headphones in collaboration with the Beatles, known as Beatlephones. However, talk to any Beatles purist, and they'll tell you the Beatles and their producer George Martin mixed their recordings with mono in mind, taking into account most people listen to records with just one speaker. Some say you get a better sound from what's called open-back headphones, which have holes for air to move freely into the back of the earpieces. However, although air can move freely, this also means that sound heard through the headphones can also move freely, probably annoying those around you. Most podcasters I know used closed-back headphones, which keep the sound contained. This also means that the sound doesn't escape and can be picked up by the microphone. One of the reasons I got interested in headphones this week was actually questioning how noise-canceling headphones worked, since they've become a lifesaver for my husband and me on flights. While some, like the kind I use for podcast editing, are insulated enough with foam and sound-absorbing material in order to encapsulate the sound I hear through them, the more active type actually erase lower frequencies, like that of engine noise. It's weird to think that you can just erase sound using headphones. But active noise-canceling headphones take the low frequency heard through a microphone and flip the sound waves, creating a mirror image of them if you were to look at the actual sound waves in an editing program. With the editing program I use, I can invert the sound to do this. However, it pretty much sounds exactly the same. In fact, you're listening to the inverted version of me saying this right now. But if I play the inverted version and a regular version at the same time, you would hear absolutely nothing, because they would cancel each other out. Information for this episode was sourced from Smithsonian.com, The Wall Street Journal, The Atlantic, and more links which can be found in the show notes at thestorybehindpodcast.com. This week on Trivia Tuesday in the Story Behind discussion group on Facebook, Matt said that Rex from Toy Story was based on the T-Rex toy from the Dino Riders toy line. He also said Louisiana Governor William C.C. Claiborne put a $500 bounty on the head of pirate Jean Lafitte. Jean Lafitte, in return, put either a $1,500 or $5,000 bounty, reports vary, on the head of the governor. No one collected either bounty. Jen said alligator comes from the Spanish El Lagarto, which means the lizard. If you'd like to talk about trivia you pick up during the week and have it read on the show, join the Story Behind discussion group on Facebook. This episode was brought to you by the Story Behind executive producers who support the show through the Patreon page at patreon.com/thestorybehind. Thanks for listening.